Hey guys, it is finally time to get all these parts that we have built in the previous episodes and get them together so we can get one really nice and rather large aircraft scale model that actually looks like an aircraft. So let's get building. First, we have a couple of small transparent parts on each fuselage half. They fit pretty nicely and it only takes a drop of cement to get the job done. For the window on the gunner's compartment, first I'm going to paint the edges of the part with black marker. After ensuring that the detail is properly in place, I'm applying small amounts of Mr. Cement SP very carefully, making sure not to touch the transparent plastic but its surroundings so that the glue can flow into the joint. Somehow the black edges create the impression of much thinner part than it actually is. Now let's move on to the bulkheads and their integration into the fuselage. Using Mr. Cement Deluxe, I cover both surfaces. After the bulkhead is in position, I will install the other fuselage half so I can get the best alignment possible. Just have to make sure not to accidentally glue the second fuselage half in. And this will be the template for each and every one of the details from the interior of the model. Glue it to the left fuselage half, put the right fuselage half for alignment, and then wait for a few minutes for the glue to cure. In the meantime, we can add some Mr. Cement SP here and there, so we can ensure a good bond. I am actually quite surprised how well all of this fits together, given all the additional details we added so far. To be fair, I expected issues despite all the dry fit tests that I did. To give the glue a chance to fully cure, I'm going to tape the two fuselage halves together and we'll set them aside for a while. In the meantime, let's assemble the cockpit. First comes the pilot's seat, which fits nicely. Then the yoke meets the control column, and then they both get glued on the cockpit floor. The instrument panel needs to be maneuvered around the wire loom, but eventually it will take its place into this composition. And now we can proceed towards the installation of the cockpit on the left fuselage half. Here I had to be very cautious about all the pipework on the bulkhead and not damage it. And without a trace of modesty, I will say that I like the way this thing looks. Now let's glue the fuselage sides together. Tape them for good measure and let them sit aside. I am still not sure to what extent those details will get obscured by the end of the build, but in any case, farewell, it was nice knowing you. Now let's assemble the bomb bay ceiling and the turret. It is not a complicated assembly, but we have to take into account the angle at which the turret is going to stay in. I don't know if both turrets are to be pointing in the same direction, but I will assume so. And for sure they will have to align with the gunner station. After I shaped and glued the cable, we will have to paint it. We have to be delicate here because it will not be very funny if some paint ends up on the wrong place. The nose assembly will have to start with some parting lines cleanup. They run in the middle of each blast tube and also on the base, so quite the task. And such things should not be overlooked, since once some paint is applied over the detail, the lines will pop up immediately. In order to drill the blast tubes out, first we need to make the center hose, which is far easier said than done, especially if you have a camera in front of you. Then I am going to drill out a pilot hole using 0.2mm drill bit, and I am going to leave this alone for now. The nose is an assembly of four parts, and unfortunately the engineering here is not great. Just the way that the nose section is split ensures subpar fit. I am aware that ICM did this to allow themselves to reuse much of the parts from one variant to the other, but from builder's perspective, it would have been much better to have a different approach. On the bright side, this is exactly how we built our experience, by solving issues. So let's move along. The next thing to do is to insert and glue in our blast tube stacks. And this step is fairly easy and the fit is not bad either. Since the main gear legs are very far forward on this aircraft, we will need quite a lot of weight in the front, 40 grams to be exact. Or at least that's the number suggested in the manual. But I'm pretty convinced this is actually the case. And because all of the weight, I added a lot of additional support structure so that the joint between the nose and the fuselage can be strong enough to carry it. We will have to figure out the best approach on filling the gaps later on, but for now, let's move on and add some other pieces of the puzzle. Like the panel where the lower turret lives. It is questionable whether or not that turret exists on the exact aircraft that I am building, but since I have no hard evidence, I will roll with the instructions. Also, we are going to install the top panel. Despite my best efforts to align and position this part so that no additional work will be needed, small steps on the cockpit side and the left side will need to be filled, sanded or otherwise taken care of later on. When it comes to the wings assembly, we have another strange and not welcome decision. The shell ejection ports are molded shut and they have to be opened up. I guess that this has to do with the different variants once again. Luckily, I have collected many tools that allow me to do this job, but it can never be as good as if they were opened up from the factory. The oil cooler details come in the form of simple radiator face. I suspect that there will be some see-through issues, so I opted to create a shroud to limit the visibility around this detail. The cooler inlet is even less inspiring object. But I'm going to deal with that after I assemble the wings. And talking about the wings assembly, here things start to look much better, as the actual fit is rather good. Working on small sections at a time, starting from the wing root area, I made my way around the entire wing without a single issue. All panel lines are nicely aligned and there is no significant step on the seam. The insert for the wingtip guns also fits nicely in place. However, the barrels will have to be replaced without a doubt. The flap system is made out of two parts for each wing, one on each side of the engine nacelle. The kit offers those split in upper and lower half. In this case, this is not an issue as the parts fit flawlessly. The installation of the control surfaces on the wing is also a pleasant surprise. The ailerons fit snugly in the location ports and the alignment is perfect. The flaps assembly is awkward to begin with, but once they snap in place, it all starts to make sense. The fit feels tight, secure and precise. On the upper wing surface, the gap is slightly larger but consistent, just as it appears on the real aircraft. The rudder is split in half as well, so with the help of some Mr. Cement Deluxe, they get easily glued together. The horizontal stabilizers come into two pieces for the main fixed plane and a third piece for the actual control surface. After gluing the fixed plane together, we can slide the elevators over the attachment points. This needs to be done firmly but gently because the attachment studs are a bit delicate. Assembling the gear base also requires some attention, mainly because of the additional details. At this point, I only glued the rear portion. The front I left free because later I used the wing as a jig to glue the forward part of the gearbane nacelle combo. This allowed me to have better control over the joint between the wing and the nacelle. When gluing the front end of the nacelle, I was paying attention to the joint to avoid unnecessary steps. The top-mounted air scoop had some ejector marks, which I had to fill and sand, only to figure out that the scoop opening will be covered by the engine cowling. Sometimes it pays off to check the instructions every now and then. After I glued the intake on the nacelle, I started messing around with the surface textures, deepening the panel lines and adding rivet details along them. The fit between the nacelle and the wing is pretty solid. There are some pretty minor gaps, but not so much to be a concern. So let's do some joint fixing, shall we? Where I needed to build up volume, strength, or I was going to scribe over, plastic glue was my weapon of choice. It takes quite some time to cure properly, but it is the closest you can get to the styrene of the model. Not that this putty does not have some other issues like pinholes and the fact that it is much tougher to sand than the regular putty, but it is worth the effort at the end. While I was sanding with all kinds of sanding devices, I had to take care of nearby panel lines so I don't obliterate them. The next layer of putty was the basic type from Tamiya. Luckily, it dries much faster and sands much easier. Unfortunately, with pinholes there is always the possibility to trap air in the hole, rendering the putty application useless for the particular hole. And in this case comes Mr. Surfacer 500 hosed on with the airbrush. And I mean that literally. I build up a nice layer of this filler primer, and the leveling thinner helps it flow and level itself out. And after another wet sanding session, we are ready to rectify the panel lines lost during the process. From all of that, what I hate the most are the panel lines that coincide with joints. The engineering of the kit has to be top-notch to pull it off. And here, due to the less than brilliant joints where the contact surfaces come at an angle towards each other, and despite all my efforts, I still got the scriber to poke through in some areas. But alright, enough is enough. I can spend months fiddling around with stuff that no one will ever notice. So let's assemble this beast together. First order of business is to insert the aiming station into the gunner's compartment and fix it in place with the canopy. I'm not going to glue the gunner station just yet. The fit of both canopies is good, partially due to the kit itself, but in some areas due to the work we did earlier. However, when I apply the primer, I may be proven wrong. We'll see. The spars coming from the bulkheads are here to provide a good fit and support for the massive wings of this aircraft. This is a very welcome solution, as relying on a simple butt joint would not be a very good idea. The channels inside the wings that should accommodate the spars could have been a little bit taller, as in their current form the spar can wander out of the channel, compromising the whole structure. And there is little to nothing that can be done to guide it, short of assembling the nacelles after gluing the wings on the fuselage, because there will be access to adjust the spars. In my case, I think I got the spars in correctly. If not, I hope that the glue will be holding them together. The horizontal stabilizers have somewhat more simple joint, but they are much smaller, so this is kinda okay. For almost daily updates of this and my other builds, visit my Patreon page. There you can also download files for 3D printing and join the community. If not, I will see you in a couple of weeks. But in any case, until next time, happy modeling, fellas!